Welcome to Life Church Panania. Thank you for joining us for our service today. We, your hosts, will be guiding you through our service. I'm Ian.
And I'm Eleanor.
And we're going to begin with an act of prayer. The act is acknowledgement, confession, and thanks. Let us pray. Father, we bow in your presence, acknowledging Jesus as the creator of this great world. You as the one who has a marvelous plan that extends from eternity through time to eternity, and the Holy Spirit is the one who indwells us so that we can be actively part of your plan. Thank you for what you've got in mind for us. How wonderful it is that you, the triune God, a creator, sovereign, Lord, master over all things. But we come to you in confession and acknowledge that we fall so far short by our sin, by our failure, by our inadequacy, by our mere humanness, by the work of the flesh, by listening to the world around us. We know that we disappoint you as we disappoint others and we disappoint ourselves. And so we come to you then with thanks. Thank you that you still love us. Thank you that your mercy overrides our sin. Thank you for your grace that brings forgiveness and cleansing. And so we rise up and praise you for your great love, for your generosity, kindness, goodness towards us, and to the whole world. And we want to praise your name. We want to lift you up and celebrate who you are in our hearts, before one another and before the world. And so we do this now through Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue that celebration of praise with a little bracket of songs. The first of them is Hosanna, which means salvation. And so let's celebrate our Saviour with the song Hosanna. Hosanna, he is our Saviour, the one who said, if you continue in my word, you'll be my disciples and the truth will set you free. So let's sing those texts now in Jesus' name.
you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Our response to that is to say, who's on the Lord's side? Who would be on anyone else's side? Of course, this is a declaration of faith and a call for those around us to also come and enjoy what we have. Let's sing, Who is on the Lord's side? On the Lord's side. So, news and announcements, what do we need to know about? Well, today is our mission focus, and we'll be having after service a Myanmar morning tea. A good morning tea, a better than average morning tea, is a reminder that we are so blessed. And with that, we want to give. Our target for giving is $1,000 per month. Now, note that this is tithes plus. We don't want to substitute our tithes to go into missions once a month, but rather continue our regular giving and then add to that our mission giving. As our church council reported to us, our own giving is well below what we need. And so we can't take away from our regular giving. We need to give above and beyond so that we might be able to continue our mission. We need to, first of all, support ourselves, of course. Otherwise, we won't exist to be able to support missions. So in giving to ourselves and then in our generosity, we give to missions as well. And we want to say thank you to those of you online who support our local church and support the mission that we have into Myanmar. And if you're not already doing that, we invite you to participate in this mission program. And then after our Myanmar morning tea, we'll spend a time in mission prayer. And in doing that, just as God has the whole world in his hands, so we, through prayer, have the world in our hands, and we'll be praying that after our service, after morning tea. But there's also another dimension to this. How do we care for one another? And we want to say a big thank you to the Australian Christian Lobby for helping us do the things that are beyond our immediate reach ourselves. And here's something that you can act on right now. If you're in New South Wales in particular, this will apply to you, but keep an ear to the ground through the Australian Christian Lobby for what's happening in your own state or in your own country, wherever you are around the world. Locally, for us, the New South Wales government just quietly withdrew $150 million from the support of palliative care to move it into assisted suicide. So this, we believe, is a retrograde step. And one of the members of the Legislative Council has set up a petition, and we want to support this member. Our petition requires, or her petition requires, 15,000 signatures. And so far, we're more than halfway, 8,178 as of yesterday. You can add to that number. And we invite you to do that. How do you do it? Well, you can Google, open your Google or whatever you use, and type in the search bar Legislative Council, because that's where this is the doorway into the parliament that we're using, signing e-petition, because that's what we're going to do, it's our action, and which e-petition, because there are several that are before parliament, but we want to focus now on restore palliative care funding. So if you type that in your search bar, Legislative Council signing a petition, restore palliative care funding, that will take you to exactly the spot that you need in a maze of parliamentary material. So your result will look like this little picture that's on the screen, and you can just simply fill in the details. It's easy. Now, make sure you disclose that you are not a robot, that you're actually a real person, and then you can sign it. It's that easy, and you're done. You can do that. Now, why would you do that? Because it's what God requires of us. What does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. We can do that, and we should be doing that. And you can do that, and God will bless you for being an effective witness for him. Now, let's turn back to another couple of songs. The world around us has elusive dreams that they can't capture, but we've got something of substance that we can remind them of. So let's do that through this first song, Elusive Dream.
Must end. Change
We've got more than an elusive dream. We have a new mind, and that's what keeps us going the right way, the best way, the upward way. So let's sing together, A New Mind. And now we're going to open up God's Word. We're continuing our studies through Luke's Gospel, and here we are up to chapter 23, and we're going to read from verse 13 through to verse 25.
Hear the word of the Lord. Then Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people. He said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him here in your presence and found him not guilty of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing deserving of death. Therefore, I will punish him and release him. But they all cried out in unison, Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us! Barabbas had been imprisoned for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate addressed them again, but they kept shouting, Crucify him! Crucify him! A third time he said to them, What evil has this man done? I have found in him no offence worthy of death. So after I punish him, I will release him. But they were insistent, demanding with loud voices for Jesus to be crucified. And their clamour prevailed. So Pilate sentenced that their demand be met. As they had requested, he released the one imprisoned for insurrection and murder and handed Jesus over to their will. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Oh, the flow is so strong, and we need to be strong so that we can go against the flow. And how do we do that? Well, we find it in our text for today, and it's about Jesus before Pontius Pilate. What we need, first of all, is a legal framework so that we can see what's happening and put some framework around how we are to understand and apply what this is telling us. So first of all, the legal framework that's presented to the crowd, and the crowd is what dominates this incident. Here we have, first of all, the judge's investigation. Here's Pontius Pilate. He's had Jesus brought to him by the priests. And what does he say? He says, I have examined him here in your presence. So unlike the Greeks who were philosophical and looked for the whys and the wherefores, the Romans were about rule of law, about just give me the facts and let's deal with the facts. And so Pilate says, I've examined him here in your presence. And he's quite open about the investigation that he undertakes. And when we are confronted with people who don't like Jesus or who are opposed to what we think about Jesus or church or faith, we need to be open and transparent about what we do know. And there is so much that we do know because we're dealing with the facts of history. But we also need to be honest about what we don't know. We're not God. We don't have all the answers. And the world really doesn't expect that. They would like it, but they just don't expect that. So we can be quite clear. I've examined Jesus. This is what I have found. And we tell our story. We move from investigation to declaration. Pilate goes on to say beyond, I've examined him. And he says, I have found him not guilty of your charges. Now, this is really interesting because here's the head of the Supreme Court. Here's the charges, examines the evidence and brings down his verdict no less than seven times. Pilate unswervingly declares that there is no basis for the priest's accusation against Jesus. Now, note this. The governor does not declare Jesus to be innocent of all the charges against him. Pilate goes much further. He declares there is not even any basis for the charges against him. Now, the governor's conclusion is not surprising to us because they're a confirmation of what we know about the entire life of Christ. Excuse me. Now, this declaration of Jesus being sinless is so important for the gospel because Jesus, having no sin of his own, he is able to take our sin into himself. And when we give him our sin, he's able then to give us his righteousness. So 2 Corinthians 5:21 needs to be part of your Bible memorization progress. The one who knew no sin became sin on our behalf. And the result of that is we become the righteousness of God in him. This is the gospel. This is what we need in order to become saved. So let's go beyond that to look at what's happening with this crowd. And the lesson for us is we need to go against the mindset of the crowd. And I use the word mind very loosely because when we look at the crowd, we find that each of them is as thoughtless as one another within the crowd. What? How do we see that? They all cried out in unison. There's no individual voice. There's no one person who's thinking or saying something different. It's just the herd moving together. Modern commentators, even non-Christian commentators of today, say we live in an echo chamber. And all we are hearing is the same mindless stuff repeated again and again and again. Where is the voice of reason? Where is the voice of logic? Where is the voice of someone who'll say, I don't agree with that? Where is the voice of someone who said, that's wrong? Where's the voice of someone who said, that's a load of rubbish? We need to be people who are willing to think differently, to use our mind. Let me give you an example. In October 1517, Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the door of the church. And since that time, the Catholics were saying one thing and the Reformers were saying something different. But down in Switzerland, there was a little home group of prayer and Bible study, and they thought there was another alternative. And so in the middle of winter in Switzerland, they baptized one another as believers. This is the first time that that had been done for more than 1,000 years. And they launched the Radical Reformation. And with that came the Anabaptist movement. They were willing to stand against the crowd, to go a different way, to seek out what God was doing and follow him. Unfortunately, the crowd is as foolish as one another. What dumb mistakes it's possible to make when you're not thinking. They cried out in unison, away with this man, Jesus, release Barabbas to us. Barabbas of all the people that you could choose. Nothing could have been more foolish. For he was an insurrectionist, a murderer, and they chose him. Nothing new about that. Mark Twain said, if you do not read the newspapers, you are uninformed. If you do read the newspapers, you are misinformed. There's nothing new about fake news, and it's becoming more and more frequent. By contrast, what do we stand with? The sum of your word is truth. Now, there are even crazy people who start cults by picking and choosing bits of the Bible that they want. But note this, it's the sum of your word. You take the whole of God's word, and that gives you the firm foundation for your life and for you to be able to say something logical, say something sensible, say something true. The world desperately needs what we have got to offer. We can stand up for what is right and true and good and noble. And so, on top of that, we find we also need to go against the practice of the crowd. They were doing all sorts of dumb things, and we need to not go with them in that journey. What were they doing? The crowd refused to listen. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate addressed them again, but they kept shouting. They didn't want to hear the voice of logic or reason or truth. They just kept shouting. God's complaint, even centuries before that, was, to whom can I give this warning? Who will listen to me? Look, their ears are closed, so they cannot hear. See, the word of the Lord has become offensive to them, and they find no pleasure in it. What a horrid indictment. We need to be people whose ears are open to the Lord, whose word is a delight to us, where we find pleasure in what he has to say. Then we can have something sensible to say and something strong on which to build the foundation of our lives. Because Scripture reminds us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of Christ. We keep coming back to hear what Jesus has got to say to us, and it's found in Scripture. There is the firm foundation. By contrast, the crowd refuses to think. The third time, Pilate said to them, "What evil has this man done?" You're asking him a question. Come on, let's reason this out. Let's think this out. Let's come to a logical conclusion. But they refuse to think. They refuse to engage with the question. By contrast, we need to be people who do not conform to this world, but are transformed. How does it happen? By the renewing of your mind. We need to be logical, sensible, thinking people. And why? Then you'll be able to test and approve what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. That's what believers are standing for. That's why we are people of faith. That's why we are followers of Jesus. And then we move on. We need to go against the direction that the crowd are going. They're pushing and shoving, but we need to be those who push back. We don't want to go in that direction. How are they doing that? Well, they are saying the ones who are making the most noise must be correct. Now, we've already seen that they're not having the greatest logic or reason. Instead, they're just making the most noise. They were insistent, demanding, with loud voices. That doesn't make sense. The voice of reason is not always going to be heard. And you will find that tragically as you move into this world. The world does not want to hear the voice of reason. And they just keep on repeating the same old rubbish again and again. Sadly, their clamor prevailed. So Pilate sends their demand be met. Notice there is no reason. There is no sensibility. There is no logic. It's just clamor, noise, repeating the same thing over and over again. Crucify, 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 crucify. It's a tragedy. We've got to be people who do not just repeat the same old sounds that we hear from the world. Let me give you a clue here. There is something wrong with this picture. See if you can pick it. And no matter how long you stare at it, you can't change that. It is the way the world sees things, and it is not correct. Do you pick what's wrong? So, as they requested, Pilate released the one imprisoned for insurrection and murder and handed Jesus over to their will. The world will always pick Barabbas and be pleased. But Jesus is the one who goes to our cross for our salvation, to pay for our sin, to allow us to go a different direction, to be people who are people of faith and logic, who are not part of the world. Because Jesus said, "I chose you out of the world. Don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. Choose to hear the sum of God's word." And when you do that, you and there are people with you, more with you than you realize. We are going a good direction. We're going the right direction. We are going God's direction. We have got something good to show to the world, to tell to the world, and to be for the world. And when you go that way, swim against the tide, swim against the stream, go against the flow, and God will bless your every effort. So our response to what we've been praying, singing, learning, and preparing to do will be to say, "I will be the one. I will make a difference. I will stand up." And in singing this song, we're calling others to join with us, to say to one another, "Be that one. Be the one who stands up for God. Be the one who stands against the world, who goes against the flow." So let's sing, "Be the One." do that. Each of us can be the one voice that makes a big difference. Thank you for being part of Life Church Panania today. And now as we go into our separate ways, may the Lord bless you, keep you, and uplift you, fill you with His Spirit, guide you by His Word, direct you into His plan, and give you strong, stable feet to walk His way. Until we can meet again, God bless you. And now let someone know that you were part of this service today. And then as you're having your great morning tea, remind yourself how blessed you are. Until we meet again, God bless you.